And that concludes the court's explanation of the legal aspects of this case. And now, gentlemen of the jury, I come to my final instruction to you. Murder in the first degree, premeditated homicide, is the most serious charge tried in our criminal courts. You've listened to the testimony and you've had the law read to you and interpreted as it applies to this case. It now becomes your duty to try and separate the facts from the fancy. One man is dead. The life of another is at stake. I urge you to deliberate honestly and thoughtfully. If there is a reasonable doubt, then you must bring me a verdict of not guilty. If, however, there is no reasonable doubt, then you must, in good conscience, find the accused guilty. However you decide, your verdict must be unanimous. In the event you find the accused guilty, the bench will not entertain a recommendation for mercy. The death sentence is mandatory in this case. I don't envy you your job. You are faced with grave responsibility. Thank you, gentlemen.
Do you want some gum?
No, thanks.
You know something, I phoned up for the weather today. It's the hottest day of the year. I mean, you'd think they'd at least air condition the place. I almost dropped dead in court.
Okay, gentlemen, everyone's here. Just anything you want. I'm right outside. Just knock.
I never knew they locked the door.
Sure they locked the door. What do you think?
I don't know. It just never occurred to me.
Hey, what's that for?
Well, I was figuring we might want to vote by ballots.
Great idea. Maybe we can get him elected senator.
Hey, how'd you like it?
I don't know. It was pretty interesting.
Yeah? I was falling asleep.
I mean, I've never been on a jury before.
Really? I've sat on juries. And it always amazes me the way these lawyers can talk and talk. Even when the case is as obvious as this one. I mean, did you ever hear so much talk about nothing?
Well, I guess they're entitled.
Sure they are. Everybody deserves a fair trial. That's the system. Listen, I'm the last one to say anything against it, but I'm telling you, sometimes I think we'd be better off if we took these tough kids and slapped them down before they make trouble, you know? Save us a lot of time and money.
Hey, Mr. Foreman, could we get started over here?
Yeah, let's get this over with. We probably all got things to do.
Well, I was figuring we'd, take a 5-minute break. I mean, one man's in the bathroom.
Are we gonna set an order?
What? I don't know. I suppose so.
Not a bad view. What did you think of the case? It had a lot of interest for me. No dead spots, know what I mean? I'll tell ya, we were lucky to get a murder case. I figured us for a burglary or an assault or something. Those can be the dullest. Say, isn't that the Woolworth building?
That's right.
Funny, I've lived here all my life and I've never been in it.
Yeah, can you imagine sitting there for 3 days just for this?
And what about that business with the knife? I mean, asking grown-up people to believe that kind of bullshit?
Well, look, you've got to expect that. You know what you're dealing with.
Yeah, I suppose. Man, what's the matter? You got a cold?
These hot weather colds can kill you. I can hardly touch my nose, know what I mean?
Well, your horn's all right. Now let's try your lights, huh? Oh, well, that's just beautiful. The fan doesn't work. Somebody ought to take a letter to the mayor. Dear Stingy, you know.
Hey, I didn't get a chance to look at the newspapers today. Anything new going on?
I was just wondering how the market closed.
I wouldn't know. Say, you on the exchange or something?
I'm a broker.
Really? Well, I run a messenger service. The Beck and Call Company. Name's the wife's idea. I employ 37 people. Started with nothing.
Hey, Mr. Foreman, could we get it going already?
All right, gentlemen. Let's take seats.
All right, this better be fast. I got tickets to the ball game tonight. Yankees, Cleveland. We got this new kid pitching, I'll tell you. Matuszewski, or whatever his name is. I mean, he's a bull, this kid. Shroom, a real jug handle, you know? Oh, well, you're quite a ball fan, aren't you? Just a quiet guy. Foreman, where should we sit?
Well, I was thinking we ought to sit in order, by juror numbers. 2, 3, 4, and so on. If that's all right with you gentlemen.
What's the difference?
I think it's reasonable to sit according to number.
Let it be.
What was your impression of the prosecuting attorney?
I beg your pardon?
I mean, I thought he was really sharp. The way he hammered home his points one by one in logical sequence. It takes a good brain to do that. I was very impressed.
Yes. I think he did an expert job.
I mean, he had a lot of drive, too. Real drive.
Okay, let's get this show on the road already, huh?
All right, how about sitting down? The gentleman at the window, how about sitting down?
I'm sorry.
It's pretty tough to figure, isn't it? A kid kills his father, bang, just like that.
Well, if you analyze the figures, I...
What figures? It's those people, I'm telling you. They let their kids run wild up there. Well, maybe it serves them right, know what I mean?
Is everybody here?
The old man's inside.
Would you knock on the door?
Hey, Mr. Five, you a Yankee fan?
No, Milwaukee.
Milwaukee? That's like being hit on the head once a day with a crowbar. Hey, listen, who they even got? Now I'm asking you who they got besides good groundskeepers.
We'd like to get started.
I'm sorry.
Milwaukee, jeez.
I didn't mean to keep you waiting.
All right, now. You gentlemen can handle this any way you want to. I mean, I'm not going to have any rules. If we want to discuss it first, then vote, that's one way. Or we can vote right now to see where we stand. Well, that's all I have to say.
I think it is customary to take a preliminary vote.
Yeah, let's vote. Maybe we could all go home.
It's up to you. Let's just remember, we've got first-degree murder charge here. If we vote guilty, we send the accused to the electric chair. That's mandatory.
I think we all know that.
Yeah, come on, let's vote.
Yeah, let's see who's where.
Anybody doesn't want to vote? All right. This has to be a 12-0 vote either way. That's the law. Okay? Are we ready? All those voting guilty, say aye.
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 Aye. Aye.
Aye.
All right, that's 9, 10, 11. That's 11 for guilty. Okay, not guilty?
Aye.
1. Right. Okay, 11 to 1 guilty. Now we know where we are.
Boy, oh boy, there's always one.
So, what do we even do now?
Well, I guess we talk.
Boy, oh boy.
Well... Look, pal, do you really think he's innocent?
I don't know.
I mean, let's be reasonable. You sat in court and heard the same things we did. The man's a dangerous killer. You could see it.
The man? He's 16 years old.
Well, that's old enough. He knifed his own father 4 inches into the chest.
Pretty obvious. I mean, I was convinced from the first day.
Well, who wasn't? Listen, I really think this is one of those open and shut things. They proved it a dozen different ways. You want me to list them for you?
No.
Then what do you want?
Nothing. I just want to talk.
Well, what's there to talk about? I mean, 11 men in here agreed. Nobody had to think twice about it, except for you.
I want to ask you something. Do you believe his story?
I don't know whether I believe it or not. Maybe I don't.
So what'd you vote not guilty for, huh?
There were 11 votes for guilty. It's not easy for me to raise my hand and send a boy off to die without talking about it first.
Well, who says it's easy for me?
No one.
Well, what? Just because I voted best? I think the guy's guilty. You couldn't change my mind if we talked about it for 100 years.
I'm not trying to change your mind. It's just that we're talking about somebody's life here. I mean, we can't decide in 5 minutes. Suppose we're wrong.
Suppose we're wrong? Suppose this whole building fell on my head. You could suppose anything.
That's right.
Well, what's the difference how long it takes? We honestly think he's guilty. So suppose we finish in 5 minutes, so what?
Let's take an hour. The ball game doesn't start till 8 o'clock.
Okay, Slugger, be my guest.
Well, who's got something to say?
Not me. I'm willing to put in an hour.
Great. I heard a pretty good story last night. This woman comes running into the doctor's office, stripped down to the
waist. That's not what we're sitting here for.
All right, then you tell me. What are we sitting here for?
Maybe for no reason. I don't know. Look, this boy's been kicked around all his life. You know, living in a slum, his mother dead since he was 9. He spent a year and a half in an orphanage while his father served a jail term for forgery. That's not a very good head start. He had a pretty terrible 16 years. I think we owe him a few words, that's all.
I don't mind telling you this, mister. We don't owe him a thing. He got a fair trial, didn't he? What do you think the trial costs? He's lucky he got it, know what I mean? Listen, I've lived among them all my life. You can't believe a word they say, you know that? I mean, they're born liars.
It suddenly occurs to me that you must be an ignorant man.
What do you mean? What's he talking about?
Do you think you have a monopoly on the truth?
What are you making a federal case out of it for? How do you like this guy?
I think certain things should be pointed out to this man.
Yeah, all right. It's not Sunday. We don't need a sermon in here.
Monopoly, for Christ's sakes.
I don't see any need for arguing like this. I believe we ought to be able to behave like gentlemen. If we're going to discuss this case, let's stick to the facts.
I think that's a good point. We have a job to do. Let's do it. Maybe if the gentleman who's disagreeing down there could tell us why, you know, tell us what he thinks, we could maybe show him where he's probably mixed up.
What's that?
Oh, it's one of the products I work on at the ad agency. Rice Pops, the breakfast with the built-in bounce. I wrote that line.
That's very catchy.
If you don't mind.
I'm sorry. I have this habit of doodling. It keeps me thinking clearly.
Yeah, well, we're trying to get someplace here. You know, we could sit here forever.
Well, look, maybe this is an idea. I'm just thinking out loud, but it seems to me it's up to us to convince this gentleman that we're right and he's wrong. I mean, if we each took a minute or two, it's just a quick thought.
No, I think it's a good one, supposing we go once around the table.
Anything, let's start it off.
Okay, how about you going first?
Not me. I think we ought to go in order, you know?
That sounds fair. Okay, in order. A couple of minutes apiece. I guess you're first.
Oh, well, well, it's hard to put into words. I just think he's guilty. I thought it was obvious from the word go. I mean, nobody proved otherwise.
Nobody has to prove otherwise. The burden of the proof is on the prosecution. That defendant doesn't have to open his mouth. That's in the Constitution. You've heard of it.
Well, sure, I've heard of it. I know what it is. I mean, what I meant, well, the man is guilty. I mean, someone saw him do it.
Okay, now here's what I think. And I have no personal feelings about this. I'm talking facts. Number one, let's take the old man who lived on the second floor right underneath the room where the murder took place. At 10 minutes after 12, on the night of the killing, he heard loud noises in the apartment upstairs. He said it sounded like a fight. Then, he heard the kid shout, "I'm gonna kill you." A second later, he heard a body fall, and he ran to the door of his apartment, looked out, and saw the kid running down the stairs and out of the house. Then, he called the police. They found the father with a knife in his chest.
And the coroner fixed the time of death at around midnight.
Right. I mean, they're the facts for you. You can't refute facts. This boy is guilty. Look, I'm as sentimental as the next guy. I know the kid is only 16, but he's still gotta pay for what he did.
I'm with you, Pops.
It was obvious to me anyways that the boy's entire story was flimsy. He claimed he was at the movies during the time of the killing, and yet 1 hour later he couldn't remember what films he saw or who played in them.
See, that's right. Did you hear that? You're absolutely right.
No one saw him going into or out of the theater.
Listen, what about the woman across the street? If her testimony don't prove it, nothing does.
But that's right. She was the one who actually saw the killing.
Let's go in order here.
Just a minute. Here's a woman. Here's a woman who's lying in bed and can't sleep. She's dying with the heat, know what I mean? Anyways, she looks out the window right across the street and she sees the kid stick the knife into his father. The time is 12:10 on the nose. Everything fits. Look, she's known the kid all his life. His window is right opposite hers, across the L tracks, and she swore she saw him do it.
Through the windows of a passing elevated train.
Right. This L train had no passengers on it. It was just being moved downtown. The lights were out, remember? And they proved in court that at night you can look through the windows of the L train when the lights are out and see what's happening on the other side. They proved it.
I'd like to ask you something.
Sure.
You don't believe the boy. How come you believe the woman? She's one of them too, isn't she?
You're a pretty smart fella, aren't you?
Hey, hey, let's take it easy.
What's he so wise about? I'm telling you.
Hey, hey, Kate, come on, sit down. What are you letting him get you all upset for?
Yeah, let's calm down now. Let's try to keep it peaceful in here. Whose turn is it?
Number 5.
Okay. You've got 2 minutes.
Oh, I'll pass it.
That's your privilege. How about the next gentleman?
I don't know. I started to be convinced, very early in the case. Well, I was looking for the motive. That's very important. If there's no motive, where's the case? So anyway, that testimony from those people across the hall, from the kid's apartment, that was very powerful. Didn't they say something about an argument between the father and the boy at around 7 o'clock that night? I mean, I can be wrong.
It was 8 o'clock, not 7.
That's right, 8 o'clock. They heard an argument, but they couldn't hear what it was about. Then they heard the father hit the boy twice, and finally they saw the boy walk angrily out of the house. What does that prove?
It's just part of the picture. I didn't say it proved anything.
You said it revealed a motive for the killing. The prosecuting attorney said the same thing. Well, I don't think it's a very strong motive. This boy has been hit so many times in his life that violence is practically a normal state of affairs for him. I can't see two slaps in the face provoking him into committing murder.
It may have been two slaps too many. Everyone has a breaking point.
Anything else?
No.
Okay. How about the next gentleman?
Well, me? Yeah, I don't know. I mean, practically all set already. We could talk about it forever. This kid is 0-5. Look at his record. He was in children's court when he was 10 for throwing a rock at his teacher. At 14, he stole a kid's car. He's been in reform school. He's arrested twice for mugging. He's slashed another teenager with a knife. I mean, this kid is real quick with that switch knife, they said. This is a very fine boy.
Ever since he was 5 years old, his father beat him up regularly. He used his fists.
I mean, shit, I would too, a kid like that.
Wouldn't you call those beatings a motive for him to kill his father?
I don't know. It's a motive for him to be an angry kid. I'll say that.
It's the kids. The way they are nowadays. Angry. Hostile. You can't do a damn thing with them. Just the way they talk to you. Listen, when I was his age, I used to call my father sir. That's right, sir. You ever hear a boy call his father that anymore?
Fathers don't seem to think it's important anymore.
No? You got any kids?
2.
Yeah. Well, I've got one. He's 20. We did everything for that boy, and what happened? When he was 9, he ran away from a fight. I saw him. I was so ashamed, I almost threw up. So I told him right out, I'm gonna make a man out of you, or I'm gonna bust you in half trying. Well, I made a man out of him, all right. When he was 16, we had a fight. Hit me in the face. He's big, you know? I haven't seen him in 2 years. Rotten kid. You work your heart out and... All right, let's just get on with it.
I think we're missing the point here. This boy, let's say he's the product of a filthy home in a broken environment. We can't help that. We're here to decide whether he's guilty or innocent of murder, not to go into reasons why he grew up this way. He was born in a slum. Slums are breeding grounds for criminals. I know it, so do you. It's no secret. Children from slum backgrounds are potential menaces to society. Now, I think that—
Brother, you can say that again. The kids who crawl out of those places are real trash. I don't want any part of them, I'm telling you.
I've lived in a slum all my life. I nursed that trash in Harlem Hospital 6 nights a week.
Oh, now, wait a second.
I used to play in a backyard that was filled with garbage. Maybe it still smells on me.
Now listen, Sonny.
Now, let's be reasonable. There's nothing personal.
There is something personal.
Hey, hey, come on now, fella. He didn't mean you. Let's not be so sensitive.
Well, the sensitivity, you know, I understand.
All right, let's stop all this arguing. We're wasting time here. It's your turn. Let's go.
Well, I didn't expect a turn. I thought you all were supposed to be convincing me. Wasn't that the idea?
Check. I forgot about that.
Well, what's the difference? He's the one keeping us here. Let's hear what he's got to say.
Now, just a second. We decided to do this a certain way. Let's stick to what we said.
Ah, stop being a kid, will ya?
A kid? Listen, what do you mean by that?
Well, what do you think I mean? K-I-D, kid.
What? Just because I'm trying to keep it organized? Listen, you want to do it? Here, you sit here. You take the responsibility, and I'll just shut up, that's all.
Listen, what are you getting so hot about? Calm down, will you?
Don't tell me to calm down. Here's the chair. You keep it going smooth and everything. What do you think? It's a snap. Come on, Mr. Foreman, let's see how great you'd run the show.
Did you ever see such a thing?
You think it's funny or something?
Take it easy. The whole thing's unimportant.
Unimportant? You want to try it?
No. Nobody wants a change. You're doing a beautiful job.
Yeah, you're doing great. Just hang in there and pitch.
All right. Let's hear from somebody.
Well, if you want me to tell you how I feel about it right now, it's all right with me.
I don't care what you do.
All right. I haven't got anything brilliant. I only know as much as you do. According to the testimony, the boy looks guilty. Maybe he is. I sat there in court for 3 days listening while the evidence built up. Everybody sounded so positive that I started to get a particular feeling about this trial. I mean, nothing is that positive. I had questions I would have liked to ask. Maybe they would have meant anything. I don't know. But I started to feel the defense counsel wasn't doing his job. He let too many things go. Little things.
What little things? Listen, when these guys don't ask questions, that's because they know the answer already, and they figure that it'll hurt them.
Maybe. It's also possible for a lawyer to be just plain stupid, isn't it?
You sound like you've met my brother-in-law.
I kept putting myself in the boy's place. I would have asked for another lawyer. I mean, if I was on trial for my life, I would want my lawyer to tear the prosecution witnesses to shreds. Or at least try. Look, there was one alleged eyewitness to this killing. Someone else claims he heard the killing and then saw the boy running out afterwards. There was a lot of circumstantial evidence, but actually there was two witnesses for the entire case for prosecution. Supposing they were wrong.
What do you mean, supposing they were wrong? What's the point of having witnesses at all?
Could they be wrong?
They sat on the stand under oath. What are you trying to say?
They're only people. People make mistakes. Could they be wrong?
No! I don't think so.
Do you know so?
Well, no, listen. Nobody can know a thing like that. This isn't an exact science.
That's right. It isn't.
All right. Let's try to get to the point here. What about the switch knife they found in the father's chest?
Well, wait a minute. I think we ought to... There are some people who haven't talked yet. Shouldn't we...
Look. They can talk whenever they like. Now just be quiet a second, will ya? Okay, what about the knife? You know, the one that fine, upright boy admitted buying on the night of the murder? Let's talk about that.
All right, let's talk about it. Let's get it in here and look at it. I'd like to see it again. Mr. Foreman?
We all know what it looks like. What are we going to get out of seeing it again?
You brought it up.
The gentleman has a right to see exhibits and evidence. The knife and the way it was bought is pretty strong evidence, don't you think so?
I do.
Good. Now suppose we take these facts one at a time. One, the boy admitted going out of his house at 8 o'clock on the night of the murder after being punched several times by his father.
He didn't say punched, he said hit. There's a difference between a slap and a punch.
After being hit several times by his father. Two, the boy went directly to a neighborhood junk shop where he bought a, what do you call these things?
Switch knives. Switchblade knife.
Switchblade knife. Thank you. Three, this was what you call a very ordinary knife. It had a very unusual carved handle. Four, the storekeeper who sold it to him identified the knife in court and said it was the only one of its kind he had ever had in stock. Five, about 8:45, this boy ran to three friends in front of the diner. Am I correct so far?
Yes.
You bet he is. Now, you all listen to this man. He knows what he's talking about.
The boy talked with his friends for about an hour, leaving them at 9:45. During this time, they each saw the switchblade knife. Six, each of them identified the death weapon in court as that same knife. Seven, the boy arrived home at about 10 o'clock. Now, this is where the stories offered by the boy and the state begin to diverge slightly. He claims that he stayed home until 11:30 and then went to one of those all-night movies. He returned home at about 3:15 in the morning to find his father dead and himself arrested. Now, what happened to the switchblade knife? This is the charming and imaginative little fable the boy invented. He claims that the knife fell through a hole in his pocket at some time between 11:30 and 3:15 while he was on his trip to the movies and that he never saw it again. Now, I think this is a tale, gentlemen, and I think it's quite clear that the boy never went to the movies that night. Knowing that a house saw him go out at 11:30. Knowing the theater identified him. He could not even remember the names of the pictures he saw. What actually happened is this. The boy stayed home, had another fight with his father, stabbed him to death with a knife at 10 minutes after 12, and fled from the house. He even remembered to wipe the knife clean of fingerprints. Everyone connected with the case identified the knife. Now, are you really trying to tell me that it really fell through a hole in the boy's pocket and that someone picked it up off the street, went to the boy's house, and stabbed his father with it just to be amusing?
No, I'm saying it's possible that the boy lost the knife and that someone else stabbed his father with a similar knife. It's possible.
Take a look at that knife. I've never seen one like it. Neither had the storekeeper who sold it to the boy. Aren't you asking us to accept a pretty incredible coincidence?
I'm not asking anyone to accept it. I'm just saying that it's possible.
And I'm saying it's not possible.
Alrighty, then take a look at this.
What is this?
Same knife.
What are you trying to do?
Yeah, what's going on here? Who do you think you are?
Quiet. Let's be quiet. Where did you get that knife?
I was walking for a couple hours last night, just thinking. I walked to the boy's neighborhood. The knife comes to a little pawn shop 3 blocks from his house. It costs $6.
It's against the law to buy or sell switchblade knives.
That's right. I broke the law.
Listen, you pulled a real bright trick here. Now, suppose you need to tell me what you proved. Maybe there are 10 knives like that. So what?
Maybe they are.
So what does that mean? It's the same kind of knife. So what's that? Discovery of the age or something?
It would still be an incredible coincidence for another person to have stabbed the father with the same kind of knife.
See? That's right. He's right.
It's possible.
But not very probable.
Listen, let's take seats. There's no point in milling around here.
It's interesting that he'd find a knife exactly like the one the boy bought.
What's interesting? You think it proves anything?
Well, no. I was
interesting. Just... Listen, how come the kid bought the knife to begin with?
Well, he claims that...
I know. He claims he bought it as a present for a friend of his. He was gonna give it to him the next day because he busted the other kid's knife dropping it on the pavement.
That's what he said.
Baloney!
The friend testified that the boy did break his knife.
Yeah. And how long before the killing? 3 weeks, right? So, how come our noble lad bought this knife 1/2 hour after his father smacked him and 3.5 hours before they found it shoved up to here in the father's chest?
He was gonna give it to his friend. He just had to, you know, use it for a minute.
Let me ask you this. It's one of the questions I want to ask in court. If the boy bought the knife to use on his father, how come he showed what was going to be the murder weapon to 3 of his friends just a couple hours before the killing?
Listen, all of this is just talk. The boy lied, and you know it.
He may have lied. Do you think he lied?
Now that's a stupid question. Sure he lied.
Do you?
You don't have to ask me that. You know my answer. He lied.
Do you think he lied?
Well, I think maybe he...
Maybe? Now, just wait a second. What are you, the kid's lawyer or something? Who do you think you are to start cross-examining us?
Isn't that what's supposed to happen in a jury room?
Listen, there's still 11 of us in here who think he's guilty.
Yeah, what do you think you're going to accomplish? You're not going to change anybody's mind. So if you want to be stubborn and hang this jury, go right ahead. The kid's tried again and found guilty sure as he's born.
You're probably right.
So what you going to do about it? You could be here all night.
It's only one night. Boy may die.
Brother, anybody got a deck of cards?
I don't think he should make a joke about that.
Yeah, well, what do you want me to do?
Listen, I don't see what all the stuff about the knife has to do with anything. Somebody saw the kid stab his father. What more do we need? I've got 3 garages of mine going to pot while you're talking. Let's get done. Get out of here.
The knife was very important to the district attorney. He spent the whole morning talking.
He's a 15th assistant or something. What does he know?
Okay, I think we ought to get on with it now. These side arguments only slow us up.
You're the only one.
I have a proposition to make to all of you. I want to call for a vote. I'd like you 11 men to vote by a secret written ballot. I'll abstain. If there are still 11 votes for guilty, I won't stand alone. We'll take a guilty verdict to the judge right now. But if any votes not guilty, we'll stay and talk this thing out. Well, that's all. If you want to try it, I'm ready.
Well, finally you're being reasonable.
Check. I'll buy that.
Yeah. Okay, let's do it.
Sounds fair. Anyone doesn't agree? Okay. Pass these along. Okay. Guilty. 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 Not guilty.
Huh?
Come on.
And guilty.
And another chap flips his goddamn wig.
All right. Who was it? Come on, I want to know.
Excuse me, but this was a secret ballot, and we agreed on this.
Secret? What do you mean secret? There are no secrets in a jury room. I know who it was. Brother, you are really something. You come in here, and you vote guilty like everybody else, and then this golden voice preacher here starts to tear your heart out with stories about a poor little kid who just couldn't help becoming a murderer. So you change your vote. If that isn't the most sickening... Hey, why don't you drop a quarter in his collection box?
No, wait a minute. You can't talk to me like that.
Let's all settle down and just talk about
it. No, where does he get the right to shout at me?
It's all right. Calm down.
Who does he think he is? I mean, did you see him?
Just sit down. He's very excitable. Forget it. It doesn't matter.
Oh, you bet I'm excitable. We're trying to put a guilty man into the chair where he belongs. And all of a sudden, somebody's telling us fairy tales. And we're listening.
Take it easy.
Oh, what do you mean, take it easy? If you like seeing a proven murderer walk in the streets, why don't we give him his knife back? Make it easier for him.
Okay, let's stop the yelling. Who's got something constructive to say?
Please, I'd like to say something here. I mean, I always thought that in this country, a man was entitled to have unpopular opinions.
Hey, let's stick to the subject here. What made you change your vote?
He didn't change his vote. I did. Would you like me to tell you why?
No. I actually wouldn't like you to tell me why.
Well, I'd like to make it clear anyway, if you don't mind.
Do we have to listen to this?
Hey, look! The man wants to talk.
Thank you. This gentleman has been standing alone against us. He doesn't say the boy's not guilty, he just isn't sure. Well, it's not easy to stand alone against the ridicule of others. He gambled for support, and I gave it to him. I respect his motives. The boy on trial is probably guilty, but I want to hear more. For the time being, the vote is 10-2. Hey, I'm talking here. You have no right to.
He can't hear you. He never will. Let's sit down.
Well, if the speech is over, maybe we can go on now.
I think we ought to take a break. I mean, one man's inside there. Let's wait for him.
Looks like we're really hung up here. I mean, that thing with the old man was pretty unexpected. I wish I knew how we could break this up. You know, in advertising, I told you I worked at an ad agency, didn't I? Well, there are some pretty strange people. Not strange, really. They just have a peculiar way of expressing themselves. You know what I mean? Probably the same in your business, right? What do you do?
I'm a watchmaker.
Really? The finest watchmakers come from Europe, I imagine. Anyway, I was telling you, in the agency, when they reach a point like this in a meeting, there's always some character ready with an idea, and it kills me. I mean, it's the weirdest thing sometimes, the way they precede the idea with some kind of phrase, like, okay, some account exec will run up and say, here's an idea, let's run it up the flagpole and see if anyone salutes it, or put it on a bus and see if it gets off at Wall Street. It's idiotic, but it's funny.
Hey, look, I was a little excited. Well, you know how it is. I didn't mean to get nasty or anything.
You a salesman?
I'm an architect.
Yeah, do you know what the soft sell is? Because, you're pretty damn good at it. I mean, I'll tell you. Well, I got a different technique, you know. Drinks, jokes, knock them on their asses. I made $27,000 last year selling marmalade. I mean, that's not bad considering marmalade. But what are you getting out of it? I mean, Kix, the boys killed you, pal, so let's just go home before we all get sore throats, huh?
What's the difference whether you get one here or at the ball game?
No difference, pal. No difference at all.
Nice bunch of guys.
I guess they're the same as any.
That loud, heavyset guy, the one who was telling us about his kid, the way he was talking, boy, that was an embarrassing thing.
Yeah.
What a murderous day. You think we'll be here much longer?
I don't know.
He's guilty for sure. There's not a doubt in the whole world. We should have been done already. Listen, I don't care, you know. It beats working. But you think he's innocent?
I don't know. It's possible.
Look, I don't know you, but I'm betting you've never been wronger in your life. You ought to wrap it up. You're wasting your time.
Suppose you're the one on trial?
I'm not used to supposing. I'm just a working man. My boss does the supposing. But I'll try one. Suppose you talk us all out of this, and the kid really did knife his father.
Okay, let's take seats.
Looks like we'll be here for dinner.
Okay, let's get down to business. Who wants to start it off?
Well, I'd like to make a point.
Pardon me.
Maybe it'd be better if we... I'm sorry, go ahead.
I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, go ahead, it's all right.
Well, I was gonna say, well, this is probably a small point, but anyway, the boy had a motive for the killing, you know, the beatings and all. So if he didn't do it, who did? That's my point. I mean, nobody goes out and kills someone without a motive. Not unless he's just plain nuts, right?
As far as I know, we're supposed to decide whether or not the boy on trial is guilty beyond a reasonable doubt. We're not concerned with anyone else's motives here. That's the job for the police.
Very true, but we can't help letting our only motive we know creep into our thoughts, can we? We can't help asking ourselves who else might have had a motive. Logically, these things follow. This gentleman is asking a reasonable question. Somebody killed him. If it wasn't the boy, who was it?
Modulowski.
You're talking about the man I love.
If you haven't got anything to add besides jokes, I suggest that you listen.
Hey, okay. I'm just letting off steam. Go ahead.
Maybe you can answer me. Who else might have killed the father?
Well, I don't know. The father wasn't exactly a model citizen. The boy's lawyer outlined his background in his closing statement. He was in prison once. He was known to be a compulsive gambler and a pretty consistent loser. He spent a lot of time in neighborhood bars. He'd get into fist fights sometimes after a couple drinks, usually over women. He was tough, cruel, primitive kind of man who never held a job for more than 6 months in his life. So here are a few possibilities. He could have been murdered by one of the many men he served in time in prison with, by a bookmaker, by a man he'd beaten up, by a woman he picked up, by any one of those rough characters he's known to hang out with.
Boy, oh boy, that's the biggest load of crap I ever... Listen, we know that the father was a bum. So what has that got to do with anything?
I didn't bring it up. I was asked who else would have killed him. I gave my answer.
That gentleman over there asked a direct question.
So everybody's a lawyer.
Look, suppose you answer this for me. The old man who lived downstairs heard the kid yell out, "I'm going to kill you." A split second later, he heard a body hit the floor. Then he saw the kid run out of the house. Well, what does all that mean to you?
I was wondering how clearly the old man could have heard the boy's voice through the ceiling.
He didn't hear it through the ceiling. His window was open, and so was the window upstairs. It was a hot night, remember?
The voice came from another apartment. It's not easy to identify a voice, especially a shouting voice.
He identified it in court. He picked out the boy's voice out of five other voices, blindfolded.
That was just an ambitious district attorney putting on a show. Look, the old man knows the boy's voice very well. They lived in the same house for years. But to identify it positively from an apartment downstairs, isn't it possible he was wrong? That maybe he thought the boy was upstairs and automatically decided the voice he heard was the boy's voice?
I think that's a bit far-fetched.
Brother, you can say that again. Look, the old man heard the father's body falling, and then he saw the boy run out of the house 15 seconds later. He saw the boy.
Check, and don't forget the woman across the street. She looked right into the open window and saw the boy stab his father. I mean, isn't that enough for you?
Not right now. No, it isn't.
How'd you like him? It's like talking into a dead phone.
The woman saw the killing through the windows of a moving elevated train. The train had six cars, and she saw it through the windows of the last two cars. To remember the most significant details, I don't see how you can argue with that.
Well, what have you got to say about that?
I don't know. It doesn't sound right to me.
Yeah, well, suppose you think about it. Hey, lend me your pencil.
I wonder if anybody has an idea how long it takes an elevator. Are you seriously playing tic-tac-toe night right now?
Okay, wait a minute.
This isn't a game.
Oh, who do you think you are?
All right, take it easy.
Come on now, sit down.
I've got a good mind to belt him one.
Now, please, I don't want any fights in here.
Oh, did you see him? The nerve, the absolute nerve.
All right, forget about it. It's not important, know what I mean?
This isn't a game. Who does he think he's dealing with here?
Come on now, it's all over. Let's take our seats.
What's all over? I want an apology.
Okay, Noisy, he apologizes. Now let's hear what the man has to say.
Thank you. I wonder if anybody has an idea how long it takes an elevated train at medium speed to pass a given point.
Now what's that got to do with anything?
How long? Take a guess.
I wouldn't have the slightest idea.
What do you think?
I don't know, about 10 or 12 seconds maybe?
What's all this for?
I'd say that's a fair guess. Anyone else?
That sounds right to me.
Come on! What's the guessing game for?
What do you say?
10 seconds, approximately.
All right, say 10 seconds. What are you getting at?
This. It takes a six-car L train 10 seconds to pass a given point. Now, say that given point is an open window of a room in which the killing took place. You can almost reach out the window of that room and touch the L tracks, right?
Right.
All right. Now let me ask you this. Has anyone here ever lived right next to the L tracks?
Well, I just finished painting an apartment that overlooked an L line. I'm a house painter, you know. I was there for 3 days.
What was it like?
What do you mean?
Noisy?
Oh, brother. Well, it didn't matter. We're all punching our business anyways.
I lived in a second floor apartment next to L line once. When the window was open and the train goes by, the noise is almost unbearable. You can't hear yourself think.
Okay. You can't hear yourself think. Will you get to the point?
I will. Let's take two pieces of testimony and try to put them together. First, the old man in the apartment downstairs. He said he heard the boy say, "I'm going to kill you." And a split second later, he heard the body hit the floor. 1 second later, right?
Well, that's right.
Second, the woman in the apartment across the street. She claims she looked out her window and saw the killing through the last two cars of a passing elevated train. Right? The last two cars.
Yeah, right. What point are you making here?
Now, we all agree that the L tracks takes about 10 seconds to pass a given point. Since the woman saw the stabbing through the last two cars, we can assume that the boy fell to the floor just as the train passed by. Therefore, the L train has been roaring by the old man's window for a full 10 seconds before the body fell. The old man, according to his own testimony hearing, "I'm going to kill you," and the boy falling a split second later, would have had to hear the boy make this statement while the L was roaring past his nose. It's not possible that he could have heard it.
Oh, that's idiotic. Sure he could have heard it.
Do you think so?
The old man said the boy yelled it out. That's enough for me.
If you heard anything at all, he still couldn't have identified the voice with the L roaring by.
You're talking about a matter of seconds here. Nobody can be that accurate.
Well, I think the testimony which can put a human being into an electric chair should be that accurate.
I don't think he could have heard it. Yeah, maybe he didn't hear it. I mean, with the L noise.
What are you people talking about?
Well, it stands to reason.
Oh, you're crazy. Why should he lie? What's he got to gain?
Attention, maybe.
Oh, you keep coming up with these bright sayings. You know, why don't you send one into the newspaper? They pay $3.
Hey, what are you talking to him like that for? A guy who talks to an old man like that really got to get stepped on, you know. You ought to have some respect, mister. If you say stuff like that to him again, I'm going to lay you out. Go ahead. You can say anything you want. Why do you think the old man might lie?
It's just that I looked at him for a very long time. The seam on his jacket was split under his arm. Did you notice that? I mean, to come into court like that, he was a very old man with a torn jacket, and he walked very slowly to the stand. He was dragging his left leg and trying to hide it because he was ashamed. I think I know him better than anyone here. This is a quiet, frightened, insignificant old man who's been nothing all of his life. who's never had any recognition. His name in the newspapers. Nobody knows him. Nobody quotes him. Nobody seeks his advice after 75 years. That's a very sad thing to be nothing. A man like this needs to be recognized, to be listened to be quoted just once. This is very important. It would be so hard for him to recede into the background when there's a chance.
Now, wait a minute. Are you trying to tell us that he lied just to be important once?
No, he wouldn't really lie, but perhaps he'd make himself believe that he'd heard those words and recognize the boy's face.
Well, that's the most fantastic story I've ever heard. How can you make up a thing like that? What do you know about it?
Gentlemen, let me remind you that this case is based on a reasonable and logical progression of facts. Let's keep it there.
Well, facts can be colored by the personalities of the people who present them.
Anybody want a cough drop?
I'll take one. Thank you.
Say what you like, right? Still don't see how anybody can think the boy's not guilty.
There's another thing I want to talk about for a minute. I think we proved that the old man couldn't have heard the boy's voice saying, "I'm going to kill you," but supposing...
You didn't prove anything. What are you talking about?
But supposing he really did hear it. This phrase. How many times has each of us used it? Probably hundreds. I could kill you for that, darling. If you that once more, Junior, I'm going to kill you. Come on, Rocky, kill him. We say it every day. It doesn't mean we're going to kill someone.
Now, just wait a minute. What are you trying to give us here? The phrase was, "I'm going to kill you." And the kid screamed it out at the top of his lungs. Don't tell me he didn't mean it. Anybody says a thing like that, the way he said it, and they mean it.
Well, gee, I don't know. I remember I was arguing with the guy I worked next to at the bank a couple of weeks ago. So he called me an idiot, so I yelled at him.
Now, listen. This guy is making you believe things that aren't so. The kid said he was gonna kill him, and he did kill him.
Well, let me ask you this. Do you really think the boy would shout a thing like that so the whole neighborhood could hear it? I don't think so. He's much too bright for that.
Right? He's a common, ignorant slob. He don't even speak good English.
He doesn't even speak good English.
Excuse me. I'd like to change my vote to not guilty.
You've gotta be kidding me. Jeez.
Are you sure?
Yes, I'm sure.
Okay. The vote is 9-3 in favor of guilty.
Well, if that ain't the living end, what you basing it on? Stories this guy makes up? You know we ought to write for Amazing Detective Monthly, right? You make a fortune. Listen, there are facts. Facts staring you right in your face. Every one of them says this kid killed his old man. But crying out loud, his own lawyer knew he didn't stand a chance. His own lawyer. Okay? You could see it. He deserves the chair.
Does he? It happened before that someone's been convicted of murder and executed, and years later, someone else confessed to the crime. Sometimes the facts that are staring everyone right in the face are wrong.
I'm talking to him, not you, okay? Boy, this guy really is something. Listen, the kid had a lawyer, didn't he? And the lawyer presented his case, not you. How come you've always got so much to say about everything, huh?
The lawyer was court appointed.
So what does that mean?
Well, it could mean a lot of things. It could mean he didn't want the case. It could mean he resented being appointed. It's the kind of thing that case that brings him nothing. No money, no glory, not even a chance of winning. And it's not a very promising situation for a young lawyer. He really have to believe in his client to put up a good fight. As you pointed out a minute ago, he obviously didn't.
Well, who in the hell could? I mean, except for God come to earth or somebody. Come on already, look at the time.
Pardon me, but I have made some notes here.
Ugh, not notes.
I'd like please to say something. I've been listening very closely, and it seems to me that this man has some very good points to make. From what was presented at the trial, the boy looks guilty. But maybe if we go a bit deeper into...
Come on, will you?
Well, there's a question I'd like to ask. And we assume that the boy committed murder. He stabbed his father in the chest and he ran away. This was 10 minutes after 12. Now, how was he caught by the police? He came home 3 o'clock or so and was captured by 2 detectives in the hallway of his house. My question is, If he really had killed his father, why would he come back 3 hours later? Wouldn't he be afraid of being caught?
Look, he came home to get his knife. It's not nice to leave knives sticking around in people's chests.
Yeah, especially relatives.
I don't see anything funny about this. The boy knew that there were people who could identify the knife as the one he had just bought. He had to get it before the police did.
But if he knew the knife could be identified, why did he leave it there in the first place?
Well, I think we can assume he ran out in a state of panic after he killed his father. Then when he finally calmed down, he realized that he had left the knife there.
Well, this depends on your definition of panic. He was calm enough to see to it that there's no fingerprints on the knife. Now, where did the panic start and then where did it end?
Look, you can forget about all that other stuff. He still came home to dig out his knife and get rid of it.
3 hours later?
Sure, 3 hours later.
Well, if I were the boy and I had killed my father, I would not come home 3 hours later. I would be afraid then the police would be there. I would stay away, knife or no knife.
Hey, listen, pal. You voted guilty, didn't you? What side are you on here?
I don't believe I have to be loyal to one side or the other. I'm simply asking questions.
Well, this is just off the top of my head, but if I were the boy and I'd, you know, done the stabbing and everything, I'd take a chance and go back for the knife. I'll bet he figured no one had seen him and that the body probably wasn't even discovered yet. After all, it was the middle of the night. He probably thought no one would find the boy till the next day.
Well, pardon me, but here is my whole point. The woman across the street testified that a moment after she saw the killing, that is, a moment after the hell train went by, she screamed, then went to telephone to the police. Now, the boy must have heard something, the scream, and known that somebody saw something. I don't think he would have gone back if he had been the murderer.
2 points. One, in a state of panic, he may not have heard the scream. Perhaps it wasn't very loud. Two, if he did hear it, he may not have connected it with his own act. Remember, he lived in a neighborhood where screams are very commonplace.
Right? See, there's your answer.
Maybe. Maybe he did stab his father, didn't hear the woman scream, did run in a panic, did calm down 3 hours later and come back trying to get the knife, risking being caught by the police. Maybe all those things are so. But maybe they're not. I think there's enough doubt to make us wonder whether he was there at all during the time the murder took place.
What do you mean, doubt? What are you talking about? Didn't the old man see him run out of the house? He's twisting the facts, I'm telling you. Did or didn't the old man see the kid running out of the house at 12:10? Well, did he or didn't he?
Well, he says he did.
Says he did. Boy, oh boy, how do you like that? Well, did or didn't the woman across the street see the kid kill his father? She says she did. You're making it out like it don't matter what people say. What you want to believe, you believe, and what you don't believe. What kind of way is that? What do you think these people get up on the stand for? Their health? I'm telling you, men, the facts are being changed around here. Witnesses are being doubted, and there's no reason for it.
Witnesses can make mistakes.
Sure they can. When you want them to, they do. Know what I mean?
Okay, let's cool it down in here.
You keep saying that. Maybe what we need is for it not to be cool in here. These guys are going off every which way. Didn't hear the scream, did hear the scream. What's the difference? They're just little details. You're forgetting the important stuff. I'm telling all of
you. I'd like to call for another vote.
Listen, I'm talking here.
There is another vote called for now. How about taking seats?
What are we going to gain out of voting again?
I don't know. The gentleman asked.
I never saw so much time spent on nothing.
It only takes a second.
Okay. I guess the fastest way is to find out who's voting not guilty. All those in favor of not guilty, say aye.
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 Still the same. 3 not guilties, 9 guilties.
So where are we? I'm telling you, we could yakety-yak until next Tuesday here. Where is it even getting us?
Pardon, but I vote not guilty.
Oh, brother, come on.
Oh, now listen, what are you talking about? I mean, we're all going crazy in here or something. This kid is guilty. Why don't you pay attention to the facts? Hey, listen, tell him, will ya? This is getting to be a goddamn joke.
The vote is 8-4 in favor of guilty.
I mean, everybody's heart is starting to bleed for this punk little kid, like the president just declared it Love Your Underprivileged Brother Week or something. Listen, I'd like you to tell me why you changed your vote. Come on, give me your reasons.
I don't have to defend my decision to you. I have a reasonable doubt in my mind.
What reasonable doubt? That's nothing but words. Here, look at this knife. The kid you just decided wasn't guilty was seen ramming this thing into his father. Well, look at it, Mr. Reasonable Doubt.
That's not the knife. Don't you remember?
Oh, brilliant.
This is the craziest. I mean, you're sitting here pulling stories out of thin air. What are we supposed to believe? Look, I'm telling you, if this guy was sitting ringside at the Dempsey Freepo fight, he'd be trying to tell us Freepo won. Look, what about the old man? Are we seriously supposed to believe that he didn't get up, run to his door, see the kid tearing down the stairs 15 seconds after the killing? He's only saying it to be important. I mean, what's the point of this whole thing?
Hold it a second.
And the Milwaukee Rooter is heard from, and pop-ups are falling from base hits everywhere we look.
Did the old man say he ran to the door?
Ran, walked, what's the difference there?
He said he ran to the door. At least I think he did.
I don't remember what he said, but I don't see how he could run.
He went from his bedroom to the front door. That's enough, isn't it?
Wait a minute. Where is his bedroom again?
Down the hall somewhere. I thought you remembered everything. Don't you remember that?
No. Mr. Foreman, I'd like to take a look at the diagram of the apartment.
Why don't we have him run the whole case over again, just so he can get everything straight, you know?
Mr. Foreman.
I heard you.
All right, what's this for? How come you're the only one in the room who wants to see exhibits all the time?
I want to see this one too.
Yeah, and I want to stop wasting time.
If we're going to start wading through all that business about where the body was found.
We're not. Not unless someone else wants to. I'd like to see if a very old man who drags one leg when he walks because he had a stroke last year can get from his bed to the door, front door, in 15 seconds.
He said 20 seconds.
He said 15.
Now I'm telling you he said 20.
He said.
What are you trying to distort?
He said 15.
How does he know how long 15 seconds is? You can't judge that kind of thing.
He said 15 seconds. He was very positive about it.
Oh, he's an old man. You saw him. Half the time he was confused. How could he be positive about anything?
All right. Here's the apartment diagram.
I don't see what we're going to prove here. The man said he saw the boy running out.
Well, let's see the details bear him out. As soon as the body fell to the floor, he said he heard footsteps upstairs running towards the front door. He heard the upstairs door open and the footsteps start down the stairs. He got to the front door as soon as he could. He swore that he could have been more than 15 seconds. Now, if the killer began running immediately...
Maybe he didn't.
The old man said he did.
Now, you ought to be down in Atlantic City's at the Hair Splitters convention or whatever. You know that, right?
Listen, baseball, why don't you stop making smart remarks all the time?
My friend, for your $3 a day, you gotta listen to everything.
Well, now that you got that thing in here, what about it?
May I? Mm-hmm. This is the apartment in which the killing took place. The old man's apartment is directly beneath and exactly the same. Here are the L tracks, the bedroom, another bedroom, bathroom, living room, kitchen. This is the hall. Here's the front door to the apartment, and here are the stairs. Now, the old man's bed is in this room. He says he got up, went to the hall, down the hall to the front door, opened it, and looked out just in time to see the boy racing down the stairs. Am I right so far?
That's the story for the 19th time.
15 seconds after the body fell.
Yeah, go ahead.
His bed was at the window. It's 12 feet from his bed to the bedroom door. The length of the hall is 43 feet, 6 inches. Now he had to get up out of the bed, walk 12 feet, open the door, walk 43 feet, and open the front door. All in 15 seconds. Do you think he could have done it?
Sure he could have done it.
Well, he can only walk very slowly. They even had to help him into the wheelchair. Sure.
Well, you make it sound like it's a long walk. It's not.
For an old man who had a stroke, it's a long walk.
Hey, what are you doing?
I want to try this thing. Let's see how long it took him.
Oh, now what do you mean you want to try it? Why didn't the kid's lawyer bring it up if it's so important?
Well, maybe he just didn't think of it.
What do you mean, didn't think of it? You think the man's an idiot or something? It's an obvious thing.
Did you think of it?
Listen, smart guy, it don't matter whether I thought of it.
Okay, now let's hold it down.
He didn't bring it up because he knew the answer would hurt his case. Now, what do you think about that?
Okay.
It's possible he didn't bring it up because it would have meant badgering and bullying a helpless old man. Something that I don't think sits very well with the jury. Most lawyers avoid that kind of thing if they can.
But what kind of a bum is he then?
That's what I've been asking. All right. Let's say these chairs are an old man's bed. I'm going to paste off 12 feet the length of the bedroom. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Oh, now come on. You're crazy. You can't recreate a thing like that.
Oh, I'd like to see it.
12. Someone hand me a chair. All right. This is the bedroom door. The hall is a little over 43 feet long. I'll pace over to the wall and back again. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Look, this is absolutely insane. What's the idea of wasting everybody's time here?
12. According to you, it only took 15 seconds. We can spare that. 39, 40, 41, 42, 43. Okay, pass me another chair, please. This is the door to the outside hall and the stairway. It was a chain locked according to the testimony. Who's got a watch with a second hand?
I have one.
When you want me to start, stomp your foot. That'll be the body falling. Tie me from there, please.
Anybody for charades?
I've never seen anything like this in my whole life.
Okay, I'm ready.
Come on, let's go here.
I want to wait until the second hand reaches 60. Okay, go.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Come on, snap it up. He walked twice as fast as that.
No, this is, I think, even more quickly than the old man walked in the courtroom.
If you think I should go faster, I will.
Oh, come on, will ya? Let's get this kid stuff over with.
Stop.
Right.
What's the time?
15, 20, 30, 35, 40. 42 seconds exactly.
42 seconds.
I think this is what happened. The old man heard the fight between the boy and his father a few hours earlier. Then while laying in bed, he heard a body hit the floor in the boy's apartment. And he heard the woman scream from across the street. He got up, tried to get to the door, heard someone racing down the stairs, and assumed it was the boy.
I think that's possible.
Assumed? Now, listen to me, you people. I've seen all kinds of dishonesty in my day, but this little display here takes the cake. You come in here with your sanctimonious talk about slum kids and injustice, and you make up some wild stories. And all of a sudden, you start getting through to some of these old ladies in here. Well, you're not getting through to me. I've had enough. What's the matter with you people? Every one of you knows this kid is guilty. He's got to burn. We're letting him slip through our fingers here.
Slip through our fingers? Are you his executioner? Maybe you'd like to pull the switch.
Oh, for this kid? You bet I'd like to pull the switch.
I'm sorry for you.
Oh, don't start with me now.
Ever since we walked into this room, you've behaved like a self-appointed public avenger.
I'm telling you now, shut up.
You wanted to see this boy die because you personally want it, not because of the facts.
Shut up.
You're a sadist.
No, shut up, you son of a bitch.
Oh, dear.
Oh.
Let go of me, goddammit. I'll kill him.
You don't really mean you'll kill me, do you?
Is there anything wrong, gentlemen? I heard some noise.
No, nothing's wrong. Just a little argument. Everything's okay. We're finished with this.
Well, what are you staring at? Thank you.
Well, I suppose someone has to start it off again.
It's getting late. What did they do? Take us out to a restaurant for supper?
How do I know?
I wonder if they let us go home in case we can't finish tonight. I've got a boy with mumps. He's out of here. The wife says he looks like Khrushchev.
Pardon, but all this fighting, this is not why we are here, to fight. We have a responsibility here. This, I always thought, is a remarkable thing about democracy. That we are, that we are notified, and that we have been notified by mail to come down to this place and decide on the guilt or innocence of a man that we have never heard before. We have absolutely nothing to gain or lose by our verdict. And this is the reason we are strong. So we shouldn't make it a personal thing.
If no one else has an idea, I may have a cue to hear. I mean, I haven't put much thought into it. Anyway, let me throw it out on the stoop and see if the cat licks it up.
See if the cat licks it up.
Well, it wasn't much of an idea anyway.
Look how dark it's getting. We're gonna have a storm. Boy, it's hot. Pardon me, don't you sweat?
No, I don't.
Listen, I was wondering if maybe we shouldn't take another vote.
Great idea. Maybe we can finish this one with dance refreshments.
Mr. Foreman?
It's all right with me. Anyone doesn't want to vote?
I think we ought to have an open ballot. Call out our votes, you know? Let's see who stands where.
That sounds fair. Anyone object? The last vote was 8-4, in favor of guilty. All right. I'll call off juror numbers. I vote guilty. Number 2?
Not guilty.
Number 3?
Guilty.
Number 4?
Guilty.
Number 5?
Not guilty.
Number 6?
Not guilty.
Number 7?
Guilty.
Number 8?
Not guilty.
Number 9?
Not guilty.
Number 10.
Guilty.
Number 11.
Not guilty.
Number 12.
Guilty.
6-6.
And we go into extra innings here.
6-6, I'm telling you. Some of the people in here are out of their minds. A kid like that?
I don't think the kind of boy he is has anything to do with it. The facts are supposed to determine the case.
Don't give me any of that. I'm sick and tired of facts. You can twist them any way you like, you know that?
That's exactly the point this gentleman has been making. I mean, you keep shouting at the top of your lungs. I'd like to be a little bit younger. It's very hot in here.
Would you like some water?
No, thanks.
It's going to rain.
How'd you figure that one out, Blue Eyes? You know, tell me, why'd you switch?
Well, it just seemed to me...
I mean, you haven't got a leg to stand on, you know that, don't you?
Well, I don't feel that way. There are a lot of details that never came out.
Details? You're just getting yourself get bulldozed by a bunch of, what do you call them? Intellectuals.
No, that's not so.
Ah, come on. You're like everybody else. You think too much, you get mixed up. Know what I mean?
No, listen, I don't think you have any right to... Loudmouth!
Wow. Look at that come down, will ya? Think it'll cool things off?
Yeah, I guess so.
Boy, look at it go. Reminds me of a storm we had last... What was it, November or something? What a storm. Right in the middle of the game. We're behind, 7-6, but we're starting to move the ball off tackle. You know, boom, boom. Boy, I'll never forget that. We had this kid, Slattery, a real ox. I wish I had another one like him. Oh, I probably forgot to tell you, I'm assistant head coach at the Andrew J. McCorkle High School. That's in Queens. Anyways, we're moving the ball. Real nice. Their line is coming apart. I'm telling you, this Slattery. Boy, and all of a sudden, it starts to come down cats and dogs. In practically 2 minutes, it was mud up to your ass. I swear I almost bawled. We couldn't go nowhere.
Hey, let's try and get this fan going, huh? Hey, it must have been connected to the lights. Would you look at that?
Some rain, huh? Well, what do you think of this thing? Steven, Steven. Kind of surprising, isn't it?
It is.
Hey, listen, that business before, you know, where that guy was baiting me, I mean, that doesn't prove anything. Listen, I'm a very excitable person, you know? So where does he get off to call me a public avenger and a sadist and everything? Anybody in his right mind would blow his stack, wouldn't he? He was just trying to bait me.
And he did an excellent job of it. Excuse me.
Okay, maybe he did. I told you, I'm a certain type of person. I can't help that kind of thing. I get moved by this. But let me tell you, I'm sincere.
Fine. We all are.
Well, isn't this the goddamnest thing you ever saw? 6-6, it's a joke.
Well, what are we gonna do about it? Can we break it up somehow?
Those six bastards in there aren't gonna change their minds.
Five of them already have changed their minds. There's no reason why they can't be persuaded to do it again.
How?
By using logic.
Logic, holy cow.
Now, just you listen to this man. He's the only one in the room who knows what he's talking
about.
You
wanna know my opinion?
Go ahead.
I think we should just quit.
Whoa, what the hell are you talking about?
Those people in there are acting like it's some kind of mission or something. Look, they're not gonna switch. So let's go and tell the judge. We'll be here all night. For Christ's sakes, let's tell him we're hung. To hell with this. I mean, what am I gonna do, break my brains over scum like that?
That is just the most ridiculous thing I ever... Look, you took an oath in the courtroom. You can't just quit.
Why not?
It's dishonest. Why don't you vote not guilty?
I voted guilty because I think he's guilty.
But you don't care what happens to him?
No. Why should I?
All right, let's stop this. We're not going to get anywhere.
Well, what does he want? I gave my honest opinion.
I know.
I suppose you don't think much of it.
No, I don't.
Hey, we'd like to get going in here again, if you don't mind.
How about him? Isn't that something?
Listen, a hung jury doesn't mean anything. They just have to start the trial again with another jury. That's not what we're here for.
What the hell's the difference? A hung jury's what they're gonna get.
Look, would you please?
Listen, I'll tell you what I think. We're going nowhere here. I'm ready to walk into the court right now and declare a hung jury.
Yeah, I'd go for that too. Let's take it inside, see what the judge has to say about it. Let the kid take it with another 12 guys, huh?
I don't think the court will accept a hung jury. We haven't been here very long.
Well, how about we find out then?
Well, I'm not in favor of this.
Well, listen, this kid would not stand a chance with another jury, and you know it. Now, come on, we're hung. Nobody's gonna change his mind. Well, let's just take it inside.
You don't think there's any room for reasonable doubt?
No, I do not think there's any room for reasonable doubt.
Pardon, but... maybe you don't fully understand the term reasonable doubt.
Oh, what do you mean I don't understand it? Who the hell are you to talk to me like that? Now, how'd you like this guy? I'm telling you, they're all the same. He comes to this country running for his life, and before he can even take a big breath, he's telling us how to run the show? The arrogance of this guy.
You mean you're calling him arrogant because he wasn't born here? Fine, I'm calling you arrogant because you were. How's that?
Please, 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 it doesn't matter.
Look, forget about it. Nobody around here is going to tell me what words I do and do not understand, especially him, because I'll knock his goddamn Middle European head off.
All right, let's stop arguing for 2 minutes in here. Can't we stick to the subject?
I'd like to go over something, if you gentlemen don't mind. An important point for the prosecution was the fact that the boy, after he claimed was at the movies during the hours of the killing took place, couldn't name the pictures he saw or the stars who appeared in them. This gentleman has repeated that point in here several times.
That's correct. It was the only alibi the boy offered, and he himself couldn't back it up with any details at all.
Putting yourself in the boy's place, if you can, do you think you'd be able to remember details after an upsetting experience such as being struck in the face by your father?
I think so, if there are any special details to remember. He couldn't even remember the movies at the theater he named because he wasn't there that night.
According to the police testimony in court, he was questioned by the police in the kitchen of his apartment while the body of his father was laying on the floor in the bedroom. Do you think you could remember details under such circumstances?
I do.
Under great emotional stress?
Under great emotional stress.
He remembered the movies in court. He named them correctly, and he named the stars who played in them.
Yes, his lawyer took great pains to bring that out. He had 3 months from the night of the murder to the day of the trial in which to memorize them. I'll take the testimony of the policeman who interrogated him right after the murder when he couldn't remember a thing about the movies, great emotional stress or not.
I'd like to ask you a personal question.
Go ahead.
Where were you last night?
I was home.
What about the night before last?
Come on, what is this?
It's perfectly all right. I went from court to my office and stayed there till 8:30, then I went straight home to bed.
And the night before that?
That was Tuesday. I was, oh yes, that was the bridge tournament. I played bridge.
And Monday night?
Hey, when you get him down to 1950, New Year's Eve, let me know.
Monday night, my wife and I went to the movies.
What did you see?
The Scarlet Circle, a very clever whodunit.
And what was the second feature?
Give me a second. The Remarkable Miss... something. Miss... Mainbridge. Bainbridge. The Remarkable Miss Bainbridge.
Excuse me, I saw that. It's called The Amazing Mrs. Bainbridge.
The Amazing Mrs. Bainbridge. Yes, I think that's right.
Who was in The Amazing Mrs. Bainbridge?
Barbara Long, I think. She's a dark, very pretty girl. Barbara Lang... Land... Something like that.
Who else?
Well, I'd never heard of them before. It was a very inexpensive second feature with unknown actors and, you know...
And you were under great emotional strain, were you?
No, I wasn't.
I think the point is made.
Big point?
I think it is a big point.
What, just because he can't remember the name of some two-bit movie star? I suppose that proves the kid was at the movies.
No, but it indicates that no one can prove he wasn't. He might have been at the movies and forgotten what he saw. It's possible. If it's perfectly normal for this gentleman to forget a few details, then it's also perfectly normal for the boy. Being accused of murder isn't necessarily supposed to give him an infallible memory.
You can talk until your tongue is dragging on the floor. The boy is guilty, period. Know what I mean, my friend? Who's got those cough drops?
They're all gone, friend.
You know, there's something we're forgetting here that I was just thinking about. Well, that's the whole business that dragged out forever, you know, with the psychiatrist and where he got all involved.
Now don't get me started with all that phony psycho, whatever you call it. What a racket it is, filling people's head up with that junk. Listen, I've got 3 psychiatrists creeping their cars in one of my garages. The whole 3 of them are crazy.
Listen, there's a point I'm trying to make. Do you mind?
I wouldn't give you a nickel for a psychiatrist's testimony.
Why don't you let the man talk? You can take 5 minutes on the uselessness of psychiatry when he's finished.
What I was gonna say was the psychiatrist definitely stated the boy had strong homicidal tendencies. I mean that he was, what do you call it? Capable of committing murder. He described all those tests, ink blots, all that stuff. And he said that the kid was definitely a killer type. Am I right?
Check. I think he said something about paranoid tendencies, if I'm not mistaken.
Right. Whatever that is. He said it. Let's not forget, we're talking about a boy who's always had murder on his mind.
His unconscious mind.
Nobody else's.
I beg pardon, but in this case...
I beg pardon? What are you so goddamn polite about?
Well, for the same reason that you're not. It's the way I was brought up. So in discussing such a thing as the murder potential, we should remember that many of us are capable of committing murder, but few of us do. We impose control upon ourselves to prevent it. So the most of these psychiatrist tests can accomplish along these lines is this. They can tell us that someday a particular person may commit murder. But that's all. They don't prove nothing.
And how come they're admitted in evidence?
Well, they have many uses, of course. In this case, they added to the general impression the prosecution was trying to create. Perhaps we would find that if we 12 men took the same test, one of us might be discovered to have an unconscious desire to kill, and the potential to carry them out. yet none of us has. So to say that a man is capable of murder does not mean that he has committed murder.
But it can mean it. Listen, if they said the kid is capable of killing, he could have killed, couldn't he?
You're the one who said, and I quote, "I want to give you a nickel for psychiatry testimony."
Boy, I'm telling you, I'd like to...
What time is it?
5 of 6, man. Look at that come down.
There goes your ball game.
Say, could I see that knife for a second?
Well, we're still tied up 6 to 6. Who's got a suggestion?
I have. Let's get some dinner.
Why don't we wait till 7? Give it another hour.
Okay, by me.
There's something I'd like to say. I mean, it's been bothering me a little, and as long as we're stuck, well, there was this whole business about the stab wound and how it was made. The downward angle of it, you know?
Don't tell me we're going to start with that. They went over it and over it.
I know they did, but I don't go along with it. The boy is 5 feet 7 inches tall. His father was 6'2". That's a difference of 7 inches. It's a very awkward thing to stab down into the chest of someone who's more than a half a foot taller than you are.
All right, give me that knife. Look, you're not going to be satisfied till you see it again. I'll give you a demonstration. Somebody get up. Anybody?
Fine. I will.
Okay. Now, watch this close. I don't want to have to do it again. Now, let's say I'm 6 or 7 inches shorter than you, right?
That's right. Maybe a little more.
All right. Let it be more. And right about here.
Oh, look out!
What's the matter with you? Funny.
Now, just calm down. Nobody's hurt, right?
No, nobody's hurt.
All right. Well, look, there's your angle. Take a look at it. Down and in. Now, that's how I'd stab a taller man in the chest, and that's how it's done. Now, go ahead and tell me I'm wrong.
Down and in. I guess there's no argument.
Wait a minute. Give me that. Ugh, I hate these things. I grew up with them.
Have you seen them used in fights?
Too many of them. On my stoop, in my backyard, in the lot across the street. Switch knives came with the neighborhood where I lived. Funny, I wasn't thinking of it. I guess you try to forget those things. You can't use this kind of knife that way. You have to hold it like this to release the blade. In order to stab downwards, you would have to change your grip.
How do you use it?
Underhanded. Like that. Anyone who's ever used a switch knife would never handle it any other way.
Are you sure?
I'm sure. That's why they're made like this.
Everybody agreed that the boy is pretty handy with the knife, didn't they?
That's right.
Do you think he would have made this kind of wound that killed his father?
Not with the experience he'd had with these things. No, I don't think he would. He'd go for him underhanded.
Well, how do you know? What, were you in the room when the father was killed?
No, but neither was anyone else.
Look, you're giving us a lot of mumbo-jumbo here. I don't believe it.
I don't think you can determine what type of wound this boy might or might not have made simply because he knows how to handle a knife.
See, that's right. That's absolutely right.
What do you think?
Well, I don't know.
What do you mean you don't know?
I don't know. Right?
What about you?
Just a minute. According to the woman across the street.
Now listen, I'll tell you something. I'm a little sick of this whole thing already, so like all this yakety-yakin's just getting us nowhere, so I'm going to break it up here. I'm changing my vote to not guilty.
You're what?
You heard me. I've had enough.
What do you mean you've had enough? That's no answer.
Hey, listen, you just worry about yourself, man.
No, he's right. This is not an answer. What kind of man are you? You sat here and voted guilty with everyone else because there are some baseball tickets burning a hole in your pocket. And then now that you have changed your vote because you said that you're sick of all the talking here?
Hey, you listen, buddy.
No, you have no right to play like this with a man's life. This is a terrible, ugly things to do. Don't you care?
Now just wait a minute. You can't talk to me like that.
I can talk like that to you if I want. If you want to vote not guilty, then you do it because you're convinced the man is not guilty, not because you have enough. And if you think he's guilty, then vote that way. Or don't you have the guts to do what you think is right?
Now listen.
Guilty or not guilty?
I told you not guilty.
And why?
God damn it, I don't have to.
Yes, you have to. Say it.
I don't think he's guilty.
Mr. Foreman, I want another vote.
Okay, there's another vote called for. Let's get this over quick. All those voting not guilty, say aye.
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 And aye. All those voting guilty.
Aye.
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 9-3 in favor of not guilty.
I don't understand you people. I mean, all these picky little points you keep bringing up, they don't mean nothing. How can you believe his story? You're an intelligent man. Well, you're not going to tell me you're not. You know the facts of life. Well, for Christ's sakes, look at what we're dealing with here. You know him. I mean, that guy over there. Well, I don't know what the hell is going on with him. All that talk about psychiatrists. Maybe he ought to go to one. Look, let's talk facts. These people are born to lie. Now, it's the way they are, and no intelligent man is going to tell me otherwise. They don't know what the truth is. Well, take a look at them. They're different. They think different. They act different. Well, for instance, they don't need a big excuse to kill someone. Well, that's true. Everyone knows it. They get drunk on wine or something cheap like that. Oh, they're very big drinkers. And then suddenly they're drunk. You gotta listen to me, all right? These people are boozing it up and fighting all the time. And if somebody kills, so what? They're dead. They get killed. Nobody cares. Family doesn't mean anything to them. They breed like animals. Fathers, mothers don't mean anything. Oh, sure. There's some good things about them. Look, I'm the first one to say that. I've known some who are okay, but that's the exception.
Do you know that you're a sick man?
Sick?
Why don't you sit down?
You old son of a bitch, who the hell are you? No! Who the hell is he to tell me that? Sick. Look at him, he can hardly stand up. Listen, I'm speaking my piece and you're going to listen.
Maybe if you just quieted down.
I will like hell quiet down. There is not one of them that's any good. Now do you hear that? No one. Now let me lay this out for you ignorant bastards. You at the window, you're so goddamn smart. We're facing a danger here, do you know it? These people are multiplying. That kid on trial, his type, they're multiplying 5 times as fast as we are. That's the statistic, 5 times. They're like wild animals, and they're against us. They hate us. They want to destroy us. That's right. Oh, don't look at me like that. There's a danger. For God's sake, we're living in a dangerous time. And if we don't watch it, if we don't smack them down whenever we can, they're going to own us. They're going to breed us out of existence.
Shut up.
Now, you goddamn geniuses had better listen to me. They're violent, they're vicious, they're ignorant, and they will cut us up. That's their intent, to cut us up. I'm warning you, this boy on trial here, we've got him. That's one, at least. I say get him before his kind gets us. I don't give a goddamn about the law. Why should I? They don't. Now I'm telling you.
I've heard enough of this. Now you just stop all of this.
How would you like me to cave your head in for you, you smart little bastard? Where the hell do you get the gall?
We've heard enough. Sit down and don't open your filthy mouth again.
It's very hard to keep personal prejudice out of a thing like this. And no matter where you run into it, prejudice obscures the truth. Well, I don't think any real damage has been done here, because I don't really know what the truth is. No one ever will, I suppose. 9 of us now seem to feel that the defendant is innocent, but we're just gambling on possibilities. We may be wrong. We may be trying to return a guilty man to the community. No one can really know, but we have a reasonable doubt, and this is a safeguard which has enormous value in our system. No jury can declare a man guilty unless it's sure. We 9 can't understand how you 3 are still so sure. Maybe you can tell us.
I'll try. You've made some excellent points. The last one, which you proved that the boy couldn't have made the kind of overhand stab that would have killed his father, was very persuasive, but I still believe the boy is guilty of murder, and I have 2 reasons. 1, the evidence given by the woman across the street who actually saw the murder committed.
And how, brother? As far as I'm concerned, that's the most important testimony in the whole case.
And 2, the fact that this woman described the stabbing by saying she saw the boy raise his arm over his head and plunge the knife down into his father's chest. She saw him do it the wrong way.
That's right. That's absolutely right.
Now let's talk about this one for a minute. She said she went to bed at 11 o'clock that night. Her bed was next to the window and she could look out while laying down and see directly into the boy's window across the street. She tossed and turned over an hour, unable to fall asleep. Finally, she turned towards the window at about 10 minutes after 12, and as she looked out, she saw the killing through the windows of the passing L train. She says that the lights went out immediately after the killing, but that she got a good look at the boy in the act of stabbing his father. As far as I can see, this is unshakable testimony.
See, that's what I mean. That's the whole case.
What do you think? How about you?
Well, I don't know. There's so much evidence to sift. This is a pretty complicated business.
And frankly, I don't see how we can vote for acquittal.
It's not easy to arrange the evidence in order.
Listen, you can throw out all the other evidence. The woman saw him do it. What else do you want?
Well, maybe...
Let's vote on it.
Okay. Another vote was called for. Anyone object?
I'm changing my vote. I think he's guilty.
Anybody else? The vote is 8-4.
What makes you consider this one vote a personal triumph?
I'm the competitive type. Okay, now here's what I think. I think we're a hung jury. Let's take it inside to the judge.
The hell are you? You said you didn't want a hung jury before.
Well, I want it now.
I don't understand that. You thought it was immoral to-
I don't anymore. There are people in here who are so goddamn stubborn that you can't even- Listen, we'll never get this thing done. We'll be here for a week. Well, I want to hear an argument. I say we're a hung jury. Come on, how about you? You're the leader of the cause. What about it?
Let's go over it again.
We went over it again. Listen, J. Walter Thompson up there is bouncing backwards and forwards like a tennis ball.
Hey, wait, you have no right to-
Oh, I apologize on my knees. Come on, let's get out from under this thing.
All right, maybe we can talk about some sort of time limit. The time is-
Quarter after six.
Some before mentioned 7 o'clock. I think that's the point at which we might begin to discuss the question of whether or not we're a hung jury.
Excuse me, don't you feel well?
I feel perfectly well, thank you. I was saying that 7 o'clock would be a reasonable time
Well, the reason I asked about that was because you were rubbing your nose like, I'm sorry for interrupting, but you made a gesture that reminded me.
I'm trying to settle something here. Do you mind?
I think it's important.
Very well.
Thank you. I'm sure you'll pardon me for this, but I was wondering why you were rubbing your nose like that.
Oh, come on now, will you please?
Right now, I happen to be talking to this gentleman here. Now, why were you rubbing your nose?
Well, if it's any of your business, I was rubbing it because it bothers me some.
I'm sorry, is it because of your eyeglasses?
It is. Now, could we get on to something else?
Your eyeglasses make those deep impressions on the sides of your nose. I hadn't noticed that before. They must be annoying.
Yes, they are very annoying.
I wouldn't know about that. I have never worn eyeglasses. 20/20, you see.
Would you come on already with the optometrist bit?
The woman who testified that she saw the killing had those same deep marks on the sides of her nose.
You have got to be kidding me.
Please, just a minute, and then I'll be finished. I don't know if anyone else noticed that about her. I didn't think about it then, but I've been going over her face in my mind. She had those marks. She kept rubbing them in court.
He's right. She did have those marks.
This woman was about 45 years old. She was making tremendous effort to look 35 for her first public appearance. She had heavy makeup and dyed hair, brand new clothes that should have been worn by a younger woman, and no eyeglasses. See if you can get a mental picture of her.
What do you mean, no glasses? You don't know she wore glasses just because she was rubbing her nose?
She had those marks. I saw them.
So what? What do you think that means?
Listen, I saw him too. He's right. I was as close as one to her. She had those deep things. What do you call them? You know.
Well, what point are you making here?
She had those marks.
Yeah, she had dyed hair and marks on her nose. I'm asking you, what does that mean?
Could those marks be made by anything other than eyeglasses?
No, they could not.
Hey, listen, what are you saying here? I didn't see any marks.
I did, though. Strange, I didn't think about it before.
Well, what about her lawyer? Why didn't he say anything?
There are 12 people in here concentrating on this case. 11 of us didn't think of it either.
Okay, Clarence Darrow. Then what about the district attorney? You think you'd try to pull a trick like that, have her testify without glasses?
Did you ever see a woman who had to wear glasses and didn't want to because she thinks they spoil her looks?
My wife. Listen, I'm telling you, as soon as we walk out of the house.
Maybe the district attorney didn't know either.
Yeah, that's what I was just gonna say.
Okay, she had marks on her nose. I'm giving you this. From glasses, right? Never wore them out of the house so people think she was gorgeous. But when she saw this kid kill his father, she was in the house, alone. That's all.
Do you wear your eyeglasses when you go to bed?
No, I don't. No one wears eyeglasses to bed.
It's logical to say that she wasn't wearing them while she was in bed, tossing and turning, trying to fall asleep.
How would you know?
I don't know. I'm guessing. I'm also guessing that she probably didn't put on her glasses when she turned and looked casually out the window. And she herself said that the murder took place just as she looked out, and the light went off the split second later. She couldn't have had time to put her glasses on then.
Now, just wait a second here.
Here's another guess. Maybe she honestly thought that she saw the boy kill his father. I say she only saw a blur.
How do you know what she saw? How does he know all these things? You know, you don't know what kind of glasses she wore. Maybe she was farsighted. Maybe they were sunglasses. What do you know about it?
I only know that the woman's eyesight is in question now.
She had to identify a person 60 feet away in the dark and without glasses.
You can't send someone off to die on evidence like that.
Oh, don't give me that.
Don't you think that woman might have made a mistake?
No.
It's not possible?
No, it's not possible.
Is it possible?
Yes. Like, I say not guilty.
Do you think he's guilty?
Yes, I think he's guilty. But I couldn't care less. You smart bastards, do whatever you want to do.
How do you vote?
Not guilty. Do whatever you want.
Oh, you are the worst son of a... I think he's guilty.
Does anyone else think he's guilty?
I don't. I've been convinced.
What's the matter with you?
I now have a reasonable doubt.
It's 11-1.
Well, what about all the other evidence? What about that stuff? The knife? That whole business?
Well, you said we could throw out all the other evidence.
You're alone.
I don't care whether I'm alone or not. It's my right.
It's your right.
Yeah, well, what do you want? I say he's guilty.
We want your arguments.
I gave you my arguments.
We're not convinced. We want to hear them again. We have as much time as it takes.
Everything, every single thing that came out in that courtroom, but I mean everything, says he's guilty. You think I'm an idiot or something? You lousy bunch of bleeding hearts. You're not going to intimidate me. I'm entitled to my opinion. I can sit in this goddamn room for a year. Somebody say something. Why don't you take the stuff about the old man who lived there and heard everything? Or take the knife. What, just because he, what, found one like it? The old man saw him right there on the stairs. What's the difference how many seconds it took? What's the difference? Every single thing, the knife falling through a hole in his pocket? Listen, you can't prove that the old man didn't get to the door. Sure, you can hobble around the room all you want, but you cannot prove it. I'm telling you, every single thing that went on in there has been twisted and turned in here. That business with the glasses, how do you know she didn't have them on? The woman testified in court. Well, what do you want? That's it. That's the whole case. That whole thing about hearing the boy yell, the phrase was, "I'm gonna kill you." That's what he said to his own father. I don't care what kind of man he was. It was his father. That goddamn rotten kid. I know him. What they're like, what they do to you, how they kill you every single day. My God, don't you see? How come I'm the only one who sees? Because I could feel that knife going in my own chest.
It's not your boy. He's somebody else's.
Let him live.
All right. Not guilty.